A few months after the Dunkirk embarkation, France collapses. Hitler indicates, however, that the war will not be won until Great Britain is neutralized. The first phase of Operation Sea Lion for the invasion of Britain begins on August 8, 1940. Mighty air formations fly over Great Britain. It is hoped that with massive air bombardments, absolute air control will be achieved, that the defense will be crushed, and that the ground will be prepared for a landing. These are terrible days for Great Britain. She is alone and isolated. The southern part of the island is continuously bombed. A landing seems imminent. Churchill plans to resist and organizes the defense without hiding the gravity of the situation. The Germans lay mines in order to block the English Channel at both ends and assemble a great number of ships for the landing. The British Air Force, aided by radar on the ground, intercepts the attacking German bombers. Although in a difficult position, the Royal Air Force begins an offensive, attacking and hitting ships and submarines which besiege the island. Along the coast of the Channel, the Germans have placed long-range cannons which hit the Dover area. In spite of daily submarine action, Great Britain trains and arms 1,500,000 men and strengthens the Air Force. On September 5th, they attack the ports of Belgium, Holland, and France, hitting and destroying a major portion of the enormous German landing fleet, which was ready to fulfill Operation Sea Lion. Thank you. German naval blockade is effective, however. During the first of the battle, Great Britain loses 200,000 tons of shipping monthly. The German submarine bases in Norway and France are supplied with additional ships for short and long distance cruising. In November, the massive bombardments of the Luftwaffe extend all over Great Britain, with continuous incursions of the ports of Portsmouth, Southampton, Bristol, Plymouth, Liverpool, and industrial centers. Nevertheless, the stubborn reaction of the British anti-aircraft batteries, together with the steadily improving RAF, inflicts heavy losses on the German bombers. The entire southern section of Great Britain undergoes repeated day and night bombardments. The population is exhausted, but they continue to resist. Great Britain is on her knees, but does not intend to give up. German losses are irreparable. Hitler decides not to land. He has lost the Battle of Britain. October 28, 1940. Italy declares war on Greece. This is intended as a blitz war. However, it will engage the Italian soldiers in an exhausting campaign under unfavorable conditions of climate and terrain. The Balkan sector, already in trouble because of the annexation of Bessarabia to Russia and part of Transylvania to Hungary, following the arbitration of Belvedere, is engulfed in the conflict. Romania, Hungary, and Bulgaria adhere to the tripartite pact. The Italian divisions attack on the Greek front along the seashore, and infiltrate the Pindus mountain chain in the direction of the Matsovo Pass. The advance stops, however, due to decisive Greek resistance. the adverse weather conditions, and the lack of weapons. The Greeks, having recovered from the initial defeat, counterattack in the region of Corciano and reach the highway between Corcia and Piralti. In order to avoid encirclement, the Italian command orders a general retreat. The Greeks continue to attack with the objective of opening the road to Berat and Bellona, which the Italians have closed because of their position at Clessura and Tepelini. The Italian situation is serious all winter long. Losses are great, and there are many victims of frostbite. In March, the Italians begin a fierce and bloody battle of attrition. On April 13, they attack with the objective of a breakthrough, executing a pincer maneuver in the region of Voiusa and Corciano. On March 27, 1941, there is a coup d'etat in Yugoslavia. This country, which previously adhered to the Tripartite Pact, now installs a pro-British government. Germany accuses Yugoslavia and Greece of having an agreement with Britain and invades both countries. As usual, the action is preceded by air attacks from two directions. From the north, from Maribor and Zagabria, and from the south, from Bulgaria, already garrisoned by the Germans. Italy also attacks Yugoslavia and occupies Lubania and Dalmatia. Yugoslavia is taken by surprise and cannot establish an organized defense. The army of the Axis advances without encountering serious resistance. However, sharpshooters emerge in the occupied zone. A few places that have troops and fortifications are hammered by an intense artillery fire. The entire Yugoslav front collapses. There are tens of thousands of prisoners. German panzer columns, starting from Bulgaria, advance along the Morava Valley and toward Belgrade. In the south, a German panzer force hinders any liaison between the Greek and Yugoslav armies. The capital is occupied on April 14th. The Yugoslav army capitulates 4 days later. The resistance does not stop and will greatly tie up the occupation troops. In the Greek sector, the German forces simulate a frontal attack on the Metaxas line in the Struma Valley and accomplish a rapid turnaround movement through the mountains. German panzer columns attack from behind and break through the liaison area between the Metaxas line and the British Expeditionary Force. This encirclement succeeds completely, and many prisoners are taken. After the capture of Salonika, the Germans advance southward and find before them the British Expeditionary Force, which has retreated toward Tesaglia and blocks the passage between Mount Olympus and the sea. A German Alpine division climbs Mount Olympus and descends from two sides, opening the road for the panzers. The pursued British troops attempt an extreme resistance at Thermopylae, and thus make time for the embarkation of their forces in Attica and Morea. The German Air Force hammers the remaining forces and hinders the embarkment, especially at Volos and Piraeus. Greece surrenders on April 23rd. The Axis troops parade through the streets of Athens. The Aegean Islands are occupied. At this time, only Crete remains firmly held by the British. German occupation of this island is accomplished by parachutists only, without artillery or tank support. The Italian forces coming from the Aegean Islands force the British naval and air forces to disperse and land on the east side of the island. The fight does not last long. There is only sporadic resistance, which gives the British time to embark. With the occupation of Crete concluded on June 1, the German campaign in the Balkans is finished. A battle is won, but the resistance of the partisan, which with time becomes better organized in both countries, occupies considerable German time and forces until the end of the war. June 22, 1941. The German troops attack and cross the Russian border. Operation Barbarossa has begun. According to the German High Command, it should, in a very short time, conquer almost all of Russia, along a line running from Archangel to Astrakhan. Russia is disoriented and surprised, since it did not expect a sudden attack. The German armies overrun unorganized Russian troops on the whole front and advance in the direction of Leningrad, Moscow, and Kiev, the great cities of Russia. The Russian Air Force, taken by surprise, is destroyed on the ground by a wave of steel and fire which engulfs everything. Each time they penetrate a sector, the Germans enlarge it and encircle the Russian troops. However, in some sectors, the Russian resistance is fierce. The great salient of Bialystok is the first to be eliminated. The retreating Russians adopt the policy of scorched earth, burning everything behind them. Several hundred thousand prisoners are taken in the pockets of Bialystok and Minsk. After the first defeat, Moscow reorganizes its forces and adopts a strategy based on space. They retreat hundreds of miles in order to organize lines of resistance. In some spots, they counterattack. The Stalin Line from the Gulf of Finland to the Black Sea, built in 1937, is overrun in several places, and new pockets are formed. In the Smolensk salient, several hundred thousand Russians are taken prisoner. Fulfilling its program of cooperation with the Axis, Italy sends into Russia an expeditionary force under the command of General Giovanni Messi. Mussolini and Hitler visit the front in September. Operation Barbarossa should be accomplished in a short time, before the winter season. The German Air Force, in spite of heavy losses, supports the advance of the panzer columns with intensive air attacks. Leningrad, Moscow, and Kiev are threatened. The great Russian rivers from the Prut to the Dniester to the Dnieper and the Donets are crossed. The Italian troops fight in the bend of the Donets River, and after bitter fighting are the first to enter Donetsk. The Russian armies seem destroyed, but fight for survival. Stalin talks several times to the Russian people, exhorting them to fight strenuously to contain and repulse the invaders. The countermaneuver of Marshal Timoshenko is the first result. The partisan resistance operating behind the German lines begins. New recruits are added and armed. The tactic of scorched earth is intensified. The Russian Air Force and armored units are reorganized. Help from the Allies is beginning to arrive. In spite of this general mobilization and new Russian weapons, the German armies continue their advance and occupy Estonia, surround Leningrad in the south, occupy Kiev, pass Odessa, and head toward the Crimea. Before giving up each town, the Russians fight fiercely and try to defend it to the last man. The Crimea is occupied. Only Sevastopol, although surrounded, resists for 7 months. What was supposed to be a rapid advance toward and beyond Moscow to reach the Barbarossa Line begins now to look like a much more arduous war, far from an immediate conclusion. Sooner than usual, the rainy season begins, transforming the plains into swamps and the streets into torrents of mud. The great German advance stops in the mud. The enormous distances from the bases begins to cause problems. Fuel and ammunition become scarce. Clothing is inadequate. It begins to snow. In spite of these difficulties, the Germans begin an offensive against Moscow in hope of concluding it before the winter. The Soviet government leaves Moscow. The occupation of the capital, constantly bombarded by the German Air Force, seems imminent. In the subway station of Moscow, Stalin exhorts the people to resist and gives instructions for defense to the last drop of blood. Those not able to fight must leave, and they are replaced by new troops under the command of General Georgi Zhukov. The German panzer divisions, under General Heinz Guderian, advance toward Moscow, but General Winter becomes the greatest ally of the Soviets. Cold and ice cause trouble with the German tanks and machine guns, and their anti-tank guns are ineffective against the Russian T-34 tanks, resulting in panic among the German troops. In addition to the problems caused by the fierce Russian winter, frostbite, lack of supplies, etc., another factor which causes the Germans problems is a new Russian weapon called the Katyushka, or Organ of Stalin. Multiple mortars mounted on moving vehicles. It is most effective. In spite of all this, the Germans continue to advance, and on December 2nd reach Kakhovka, a suburb of Moscow. But this is as far as they get. With their tanks all but immobilized by the severity of weather, the Germans begin to pull back on December 5th. And on December 6th, General Zhukov attacks with 7 fresh, well-equipped and well-trained armies. Throughout December and January, they attack the retreating German army and deal a fateful blow to the Germans. From this point on, Hitler's power declines and his dream begins to collapse. After the retreat and loss of Kyrenika, the Italian troops form the defensive front of the Aquila Marada. Reinforcements of the Africa Corps begin to arrive, as agreed between Hitler and Mussolini. The German armies, under the command of General Rommel, are composed of the 5th Light Panzer Division, to which is added the 15th, 21st, 90th, and finally the 164th Panzer Division. The Italians have the remnants of the Brescia, Bologna, Pavia, and the Sabrata Division stationed in Tripoli. The Panzer Division Ariati and the Tarento Divisions arrive. Rommel, the Desert Fox, immediately launches an offensive on 3 fronts, along the sea coast, in the Gabelle, and in the desert, with the objective of the Gulf of Bomba, an encirclement of the British forces. Bombed by the Italian-German Air Force, the British troops retreat to the east. Rommel exploits the unexpected success, passes the Straits of En al-Ghazala, the Well of the Gazelles, and advances toward Tobruk, which he besieges but cannot take. The advancing German tanks meet and engage the retreating rear guards and destroy several units. The rapidly advancing Italian-German forces reach Bug-Bug, the furthest point previously reached by the Italian offensive. The supply of war material and of troops is vital for the war in Africa. On the route from the continent to Libya is, however, the spine of Malta, the British air and naval base from which the British try to intercept the convoys. The action to neutralize Malta is conducted vigorously by the Italian and German Air Force. The British destroyers react vigorously against the bombers, and losses on both sides are enormous. The siege of Malta is almost complete. But as the air attacks slow down, the island receives reinforcements, and the losses of the convoys directed toward Libya increases. On December 7, 1941, Japan attacks the American fleet in Pearl Harbor. 4 days later, Italy and Germany declare war against the United States. The rapid advance of Rommel has increased the distance from his bases. The British attack several times until on December 8, 1941, under the enormous pressure of the 8th Army, Rommel begins to retreat. The British liberate besieged Tobruk and continue to advance with massive forces. They reach the border of Tripoli. The British forces attack the convoys directed toward the ports of Libya. The Italian-German forces make the arrival of supplies to Malta difficult. The encounters, with heavy losses on both sides, are frequent. The battles of Sirte and Pantelleria are the most important ones, as far as the number of ships is concerned. On the African front, where the war fortunes alternate, Rommel, after a short period of inactivity, attacks on January 21, 1942, and reaches the Well of the Gazelles, where he stops for 2 months. The British have built fortifications there. On the offensive, after fierce fighting, the Italian-German troops pass the Well of the Gazelles and continue their advance to Fort Capuzzo. At the same time, a great force attacks the surrounded fortress of Tobruk. Tobruk falls on June 21st. The fleet, which protected this heavily fortified base, is attacked before it can flee. The captured booty is enormous. Crossing borders, Rommel reaches Sidi El Barani and Marsa Matruk, which are connected to Alexandria by railroad. On June 29th, Italian troops reach El Alamein. This is the closest they will come to Alexandria. To the south, in the desert, Italian armored columns reoccupy the oasis of Jarabub and the Egyptian oasis of Siva. From El Alamein, the attack is directed toward Alexandria and Cairo. On this much contested front, the fate of battle is changing again, for the last time. In July 1942, the Italian-German forces are stationed from El Alamein to the depression of El Kotara, approximately 60 miles from Alexandria. Rommel has tried in vain, with the 90th Light Panzer Division and the Italian Division Ariente, to break the Allied defenses. The equilibrium of the forces begins to change rapidly in favor of the Allies, which receive fresh troops from the nearby bases of Egypt and the Middle East. The British attack on July 9th. The First Battle of El Alamein is furious and continues until July 27th. The Italian-German troops succeed in halting and later in repulsing the British tanks and air force. The forces are almost equal on both sides. Rommel executes a double maneuver, piercing the center and encircling the right flank, with the goal of breaking through the front and continuing toward Cairo. The enormous fuel consumption caused by the sandy terrain and the fact that the convoys carrying supplies are sunk during their trip from Italy force Rommel to suspend all action. The British, who have received enormous reinforcements of men and supplies, begin a ponderous offensive which will determine the destiny of the entire front. The preponderance of the forces and the absolute domination of the Air Force determine the outcome of this gigantic encounter from the very beginning. Berlin and Rome exhort their forces to resist. Rommel, however, considers it more opportune to retreat to positions more adapted for defense. initiative has definitely passed to the British. The intense bombing of the British Air Force combines with the irresistible action of the tanks. On November 4th, Rommel is authorized to abandon his position. Some artillery posts try to stop the advance of the British in various places, and the remaining forces retreat to the west. The great retreat has begun. There is no longer any army in Africa capable of opposing the 8th Army of Montgomery. Both Kyrenica and the line of resistance on the border of Tripoli are lost. The British 8th Army attacks the Italian-German forces. The very serious situation becomes tragic when Rommel is informed that the Anglo-American forces have landed in Morocco and Algiers. Forces which could have been sent to help him are sent to oppose the action of the Anglo-American landing force. The Italian-German panzer formations reach the new front, which has been created in addition to the front in Libya. Here, too, the Anglo-American Air Force dominates the sky. Hitler accuses the government of Pétain of not having adequately resisted the landing of the Anglo-American forces in North Africa. He declares that all of France will now be occupied by the Germans. Suspecting that the French Navy might depart to the ports of North Africa, the Germans also occupy the French Navy base of Toulon. The French Navy scuttles itself. The Italians enter Nice, Provence, and Corsica. Darlan, Secretary of the Navy of the government of Pétain, has secret contacts with high Allied authorities. Darlan contributes an anti-German French government in Algeria. Pétain and Laval, in order not to break off rapport with Hitler, assume the official attitude of violent protests against the Anglo-American action. After the fall of Tripoli, the Italian-German units retreat toward Tunisia, on the line of Merath. Other units assemble in the northwest. The encounters follow with alternating fortune until the great Anglo-American offensive destroys the Italian-German forces. The last fierce resistance in Africa is on the peninsula Cape Bon. Spring, 1942. After the winter retreat, the Germans assume defensive positions, then attack in Crimea, on the southern wing of the front. The actions are preceded by intense air attacks, especially on the Kerch Peninsula, which was conquered and lost during the winter battles. In order to relieve the pressure on Kerch, the Russians release a great offensive in the region of Krakow and form a deep wedge on the German front. The German counterattack follows, and on May 17th, General von Kleist begins a great pincer movement from the south, and General von Paulus another one from the southwest, with the objective of conquering the Soviet salient. After a five-day battle, the Russian forces are surrounded on the right bank of the Donets. The Russian losses of men and supplies are enormous, but the Germans, too, pay dearly for their success in this bitter fighting. The rounding up of the prisoners to send them behind the lines becomes a major logistics problem. Hitler, who 1 year earlier assumed the supreme command of the German armies and personally directs the new fight in Russia, has his first success in the Crimea, where Sevastopol resists for 7 months. Together with the German troops, enormous Romanian forces which operate in this sector will play an important part in the conquest of Sevastopol and will suffer heavy losses. The Russian fortress is also attacked from the sea by the Romanian Navy of the Black Sea. The inhabitants, besieged for 7 months and suffering repeated air attacks, helped to defend the fortifications. In order to relieve the pressure on Sevastopol, the Russians land at Yalta and Yevpatoria on the Crimea Peninsula and in Melitopol. The German attack against the fortified circle is uninterrupted. The lines around the city fall one after the other. The defense is fierce, and at times the Russians counterattack. Sevastopol is a heap of ruins. The fight continues in the streets of the city. On July 3rd, the Russian resistance is finished. One month later, Churchill is in Moscow and promises a landing in North Africa and a second front in France. The Germans intend to break through the south in order to accomplish a vast encirclement of Moscow. They begin the great battles of the Don and the Donets rivers with participation of Italian troops. After cruel encounters, the Donets is bypassed. Timoshenko attempts in vain a diversive action in the north, in the sectors between Orel and Voronezh. After having reached and passed the Don, the Germans reoccupy Rostov. The road to the Volga and the Caucasus are now open. Advancing to the bend of the Don, the Germans arrive at the Volga, and on July 28th, the Battle of Stalingrad begins. Advancing beyond Rostov, the Germans pass the Kuban area and move toward the Caucasus with the objective of occupying the oil fields of Baku. The thick white line on the map indicates the farthest advance of the Germans in the summer of 1942. Italian Alpine troops occupy the refuge on Mount Elburz and reach the top of the mountain. Battle of Stalingrad begins on July 28, 1942, in the heat and dust of the steppes. The German operation, preceded by bombings, consists of a pincer maneuver with two simultaneous actions from the north and the south. The advance from the south is stopped by the Russians. In the north, von Paulus passes the Don and bombards the periphery of Stalingrad. The conquest of Stalingrad is part of the great plan of encirclement of Moscow, with a vast initial maneuver from the south and an attack on Moscow from behind. After many attacks, opposed by the Katushkas, or organs of Stalin, the Germans reach the periphery of Stalingrad, already a heap of rubbish, on August 28th. Bloody battles take place on the streets of the suburban areas. There are fights for each house. The ground is defended and conquered inch by inch. The Russians are cloistered in the big factories, Red October, Red Barricade, and Skorninsky, where work continues in the underground halls. Enormous ruins clutter the streets and squares and make it difficult for the tanks to enter the city. There is now man-to-man fighting. The battle for positions begins. For 2 months, the Russians are on a fierce defensive. Hitler announces the imminent fall of Stalingrad. But soon, the outcome will change as the Russians begin to attack. Hitler sees in Stalingrad a symbol of prestige and gives von Paulus the order to conquer the fortress at any cost. Winter descends earlier than usual on the fearful scenery of the battle. In October, the Soviets begin an encirclement of Stalingrad from the northwest and the southeast. They break through the German lines with powerful panzer columns. On November 21, 1942, the advancing columns of the pincer meet. The Russian encirclement around the Germans is now completed, and the Germans are the besieged. A great battle erupts on the steppes between the bends of the Don and the Volga rivers. The Russians want to eliminate the surrounded Germans. The Germans want to break the ring around the 6th Army of von Paulus. Fighting continues in the meanwhile on the streets of the destroyed city. Any hope to break the circle of fire which surrounds the Germans in Stalingrad is now gone. The Russian Air Force begins to predominate and hammers the German positions already exhausted from many months of bloody battles. On January 8, 1943, the Russians offer von Paulus surrender with honor, but he refuses. On January 9, the operation of annihilation begins. On January 15th, the resistance of the external circle of the city is broken. On February 3rd, von Paulus signs the capitulation of the 6th German Army. The fall of Stalingrad signals a decisive turn in the conflict. The collapse of the Germans' might begins. At the same time as this action takes place, the Russians launch another attack on December 11, 1942, which results in the collapse of the front on the Don, held by the Germans and their allies. The great retreat of the Don, Italians of that sector included, begins. It is a bitter march for hundreds of miles, with enormous privations, polar weather, furious storms, machine gunned by the enemy, who appears everywhere. The second winter campaign nullifies all German conquests of the previous summer and has a detrimental influence on the morale of the troops and civilians. The Germans who have capitulated in Stalingrad are marched through the streets of Moscow to celebrate the victory.